Okay, hello everyone. While your plates are being cleared and dessert is being served, we have a special treat. Tota Oliveira is going to give us a talk while we have our dessert. Now, for those of you who do not know about Toto's research, there is something that everyone here, I am pretty sure, is used in their lab, and that's DNA ligase. And it was actually Toto who both discovered and biochemically characterized DNA ligase. Now, actually, that's wrong. I know many of you have not used DNA ligase, but I'm just saying postdocs and students in your lab have used DNA ligase. Okay, but that's not what Toto's going to talk to us about today. You can see up here cone shells. They're prey. All cone shells are venomous predators. That sounds pretty bad. Their venoms are very complex. So I have something actually for the grandchildren to show you that I really take this seriously. I happen to have a collection of. Huh? Are they not beautiful? They're beautiful, but unfortunately, Toto has told me that these are very venomous. In fact, they're so venomous that sometimes the venom can actually even go through plexiglass. So it's like, no help from the Taylor grandchildren. So here's Toto.
Well, that was certainly the most dramatic introduction. It's a great pleasure and an honor to be here. It's also a challenge what to say after dinner to such an audience, I join everyone in, of course, congratulating Palmer and the organizers who really come up with a fantastic symposium. So, since we've had dinner and a fair amount of wine, I thought today I'd sort of give you a progress report concentrating on one cone snail. And the reason for doing this is because you've heard a lot about ion channels, natural products. But in fact, we very often forget that these natural products that affect ion channels and receptors are made by living organisms. And the fact of the matter is, we very seldom know the context for the evolution of particular natural products. And I think cone snails present an opportunity because the biology is so strong that over the years, I think we couldn't help but learn some biology along with the biochemical and molecular work and pharmacological work that we were doing. So my main goal today is to convince you that cone snails are really pretty good pharmacologists. And I hope that you'll see that. But there are approximately 700, perhaps 800 species of cone snails. And each cone snail is pretty specialized. And so this species will only eat fish, this species will only eat other snails, and this species will only eat certain types of worms. All cone snails are predators, and all cone snails are venomous, and their venoms are, in fact, very complex. Now, very often after you've been working on a problem for many years, people ask you, why did you start on it? What was your grand vision? But the truth of the matter is we started working on cone snails because we had nothing else to do at the time. So I went from the Stanford Biochemistry Department, which arguably at the time was the best equipped biochem lab in the world, to a laboratory in my first faculty position at the University of the Philippines. And I basically started with an empty room. And it was clear that we weren't going to be real competitive in DNA replication. So we had to find something else to do. And that's why I'm working on cone snails. So I had collected shells as a kid, and everybody knows that cone snails can kill people. And in fact, most of the fatalities are due to this species, Conus jarvis. And in the absence of medical intervention, the fatality rate is actually quite high, 70%. And so at the time, we thought, well, you know, until we get our equipment and until we can work on DNA replication, let's figure out why these snails kill people. And so I learned how to purify enzymes. And so we thought, well, we should be able to purify the components that kill people. And so with Lourdes Cruz, we started doing that. And we ended up with two components of the venom shown here that we believe are responsible for the lethality of this snail. The first component was a 13 amino acid peptide, which was the first bioactive component from cone snail venoms purified. And that we call alpha-conotoxin G1. And it turns out that this is a nicotinic antagonist. And in fact, Palmer's lab, Steve Sein, showed that this class of conotoxins are very, very specific. They actually prefer binding to one of the ligand binding sites in the nicotinic receptor and differentiate between the two sites by typically several orders of magnitude. So this was the first lethal component. And when you inject this into any vertebrate, then you get paralysis because, of course, you block neuromuscular junctions. The second component, which now is called mu conotoxin G3A, has, of course, a different mechanism. It acts like tetrodotoxin, although it's chemically completely unrelated. But again, very early on, it was clear that this was very specific, much more specific than tetrodotoxin. At the time, SOTU channels had not yet been cloned, and we found that this peptide would only affect sodium channels on muscle membranes and that it would not affect axonal sodium channels. And we wanted to say in our paper that this therefore suggested that there must be more than one type of sodium channel. However, the field of neuroscience, of course, loved Hodgkin and Huxley so much that they didn't want anything that said that there was not the sodium channel and the potassium channel. And so we were not, in fact, allowed to suggest that this peptide was an indication that there was more than one molecular type of sodium channel. But this peptide is extremely specific for NAD1.4, the type of sodium channels that you find on muscle membranes. So, when we isolated these two peptides, I think we addressed the question of why this snail is so lethal. The reason it's lethal is because when you get stung by the snail, it's equivalent to being bitten by a cobra and eating a lethal dose of pufferfish at the same time. And so, of course, that's not good for you, and that accounts for the 70% lethality. But you might say, well, if you answered the scientific question that you wanted to address, why are you still working on cone snails today? The reason, of course, is because a student in the lab, an undergraduate, did a key experiment. So I really think that one reason why we're all extremely fortunate to be at universities is because the students do what they want, not what we tell them. And you'll see that that really was a big factor in our research on cone snails. So when we isolated the two peptides I just showed you, what we were doing was we were injecting mice intraperitoneally and looking for paralysis, because we knew, the medical literature said, that people that stung by cone snails, they apparently died because their diaphragms got paralyzed. And so that was the assay we were using. But then this kid came into our lab, Craig Clark was his name, and he said, you know, you guys are doing the assay all wrong. You really shouldn't be injecting these mice IP. You should be injecting mice directly into the nervous system. And I didn't think that that was such a good idea, but again, fortunately, Craig did the experiment anyway. And so what he found was that when he did that, this is an HPLC chromatogram of the peptides from this one snail, from Conus jarvis, that are about 20 amino acids in length. So we would separate the crude venom into smaller peptides, about 15 amino acids, and there was a fraction that was about 20 amino acids, and then there were two additional fractions. So this is only one of four fractions. And what Craig did was he injected each of these peaks into the brain of a mouse, so it was an intracranial injection, and from these peaks he got paralysis. This peak made mice jump and twist as they're jumping. This peak made mice uncoordinated. This put mice to sleep and then wake up after 12 or 24 hours and be perfectly fine. But that was only true if the mice were under 3 weeks of age. If they were over 3 weeks of age, instead of going to sleep, they would climb the sides of their cages constantly. So Craig called this the sleeper climber peptide. There was a peptide that made them drag their back legs. There was another peptide that made them run around in circles. There was another peptide that made their head swing back and forth. One peptide that made them kick on their back and scratch. A peptide that made them comatose. A peptide that caused trembling. A peptide that caused scratching. And a peptide that caused convulsions. And there were a few fractions that didn't do anything. But as you can see, the really remarkable result is that every fraction caused a behavioral phenotype. And that experiment told us for the first time that the venom was not a mixture of a few paralytic toxins, but was rather this very complex pharmacological mixture. And so the question really is, why is there such a complex pharmacological brew that's in the venom of this one snail? And what I'd like to do today is focus my talk on where we are answering that question. And so I'll try to give you a progress report on our understanding of how this chromatogram, and we know pretty much all of the peptides, because of course these days it's very easy to do transcriptome analysis, and so we know what these peptides are. But what's slower, what's harder, is to figure out what each of these peptides do. And what's even slower is to figure out why the snail evolved them in the first place. And so what I'm going to try to do is to organize this talk with those themes, starting from this experimental result where you have this extreme complexity of peptide toxins present in a single venom. Just to continue the history, Craig not only devised this assay, but he recruited a bunch of fellow undergraduates to come to our lab, and each undergraduate could choose any snail they wanted and use Craig's assay and follow any activity they wanted, and their job was to purify this activity until we knew what the chemical composition was of the peptide from the venom that caused that activity. And so this guy, whom many of you probably know, was an 18-year-old kid when Craig recruited him to the lab, and he chose to work on a snail called Conus magnus, and he followed an activity that caused mice to have tremors when injected into the central nervous system, and so he called that the shaker peptide. And he purified that peptide, and the reason I'm telling you this is because here's the peptide that was purified by Michael, and today this is an approved drug for intractable pain. It's called Prialt, or ziconotide, and it is a very specific inhibitor of N-type calcium channels, CAV2.2. And so using this very crude assay, we were able to isolate a number of different peptides that ultimately became applied for both research purposes, diagnostic purposes, and therapeutic purposes. So what do these snails do with these peptides? Here's a typical fish hunting cone snail. This is Conus catus. And when it sniffs a fish with its siphon, it extends its highly distensible proboscis towards the fish, as you can see here. And this particular species aims for the lateral line. And when it touches the skin of a fish, what happens is from the tip of the proboscis, which is touching the skin, out comes a harpoon-like tooth, which is both harpoon and hypodermic needle. And the venom flows through the proboscis and flows through the harpoon-like tooth, which is hollow. And at the end, it's shaped like a harpoon, but like a hypodermic needle, there's an opening at the end. And so the venom flows through here. And so what happens is, because this is shaped like a harpoon, it's used like a harpoon, and this harpoon-like tooth tethers the fish mechanically. And as the fish is mechanically tethered, it's being injected with the venom of the snail. And so you can see here's a side view, and it really does look like a harpoon. And the way this is used is that there's an organ that's called the radula sac, and the snail uses one harpoon at a time when it goes hunting. And the venom is made in this venom gland and pressed out by this venom ball. And so the venom flows through the pharynx, through the distensible proboscis. And when this snail harpoons a fish, then it flows into the fish through this disposable harpoon-like tooth. So the snails essentially evolved a drug delivery device about 45 million years ago, which is the equivalent of disposable hypodermic needles. And so they throw away the harpoon after each use. So how do they use this? When they finally harpoon the fish, you can see the fish is tethered, and in a few seconds, it's immobilized. And what I'd like you to notice is that this fish has very stiff fins, and now, because it's tethered, the snail withdraws the proboscis towards this false stomach, and what it does is it engulfs the fish, and this becomes a pre-digestion chamber in which proteases, collagenases, etc. will be released, and in about an hour and a half, this snail will regurgitate the scales and bones of the fish and the one harpoon that it used for injecting venom. And so that's how these cone snails make a living. And in this particular video, I'd like you to notice that the fins of this fish are very, very stiff. It's almost as if the fish had been electrocuted. So what we did to examine this biochemically was we isolated all the peptides from a single venom, this happened to be from Conus geographus, that paralyze fish. And typically, you can isolate between 5 and 10 separate components of the venom that by themselves will paralyze a fish. And as you can see, some of them are related to each other, some are not. But what all of them do is they interfere with neuromuscular transmission. And so one group of these will inhibit presynaptic voltage-gated calcium channels. Another group will inhibit the nicotinic receptor. And just for good measure, in addition to wiping out the presynaptic terminus and the postsynaptic terminus, the snails make a sodium channel antagonist that wipe out the action potential on the muscle membrane. So any one of these is sufficient to paralyze a fish. And yet the snail is making all of them in its venom. So what's going on here? Again, probably 45 million years ago or so, the snails discovered combination drug therapy, that it's always more effective to use a combination of pharmaceutical agents rather than a single pharmacological agent. So we call groups of toxins that act together in a synergistic manner cabals, because a cabal is a secret society out to overthrow existing authority. And so these overthrow the normal physiology of the envenomated animal. And so here are the toxins, and here are the pharmacological sites that they target. And you can see that every single one of them acts on the neuromuscular circuitry. And so they wipe that out. And so that's why we call this the motor cabal. So we were actually rather pleased with ourselves when we figured this out. But in fact, there's a problem. You can take any one of these peptides and inject a fish, and you'll paralyze a fish, but it typically will take you 30 seconds or so. Why? Because from the site of injection to the time the peptide gets to the neuromuscular junctions that it inhibits, it has to enter the circulation, and there's a transit time of maybe 20 or 30 seconds. Furthermore, when you inject the fish, it's all flaccid. And that's, of course, not what you see when you actually see what these snails do to fish. So here's another fish hunting cone snail. It's extending its proboscis. And this is real time. And so I'd like to show you that it doesn't take 30 seconds for a snail to immobilize a fish. And as you can see, the fish is already immobilized in a few seconds, and now the snail is completely engulfing. So this is your typical strategy for these snails to hunt fish. So the motor cabal, first of all, does not account for the speed with which the venom acts, and when you inject motor cabal toxins, either singly or in combination, the fish looks like this. All its neuromuscular junctions are paralyzed, and so in fact, all of the fin musculature is relaxed. And yet, if you notice the videos, that's not what happened. As soon as this snail struck the fish, all of its fin musculature became very stiff. This is an effect we call excitotoxic shock. And the explanation is that within the venom, the motor cabal is not the only component. There is a second component, which we call the lightning strike cabal. And that's responsible for the very, very rapid immobilization of fish. And so what we found was that all lightning strike cabals have at least two components, which we call kappa toxins and delta toxins. And what I'm going to show you is an animation that shows you how the lightning strike cabal acts. And so typically, a nervous system, axons in a nervous system are firing action potentials. Action potentials are transient. And as Hodgkin and Huxley explained, they're carried by voltage-gated sodium channels, which open up when the membrane becomes depolarized, and as Bill explained today, rapidly inactivate, and then potassium channels open up, and that repolarizes the membrane. So two things repolarize the membranes: the inactivation of sodium channels and the opening of potassium channels. And that's why action potentials are transient. So what does the snail do to cause this very rapid immobilization? And it targets these sodium channels with a delta toxin. And when the delta toxin binds, sodium channels open normally, but now the delta toxin inhibits inactivation, so those sodium channels remain open. And if you now combine that with a potassium channel blocker, a capotoxin, you have essentially inhibited both mechanisms for repolarizing the membrane, and this membrane then becomes massively depolarized, and you generate action potentials, and that's what causes the effect on the fish. So these toxins do not have to travel very far. All they have to do is to bind to the closest axons in the neighborhood of the injection site. And by keeping sodium channels open and blocking potassium channels at the axons near the injection site, they're able to cause the fish to become immobilized with very, very stiff fins, because essentially the nervous system of the fish is generating an electrical storm. And so this really behaves very much as if you took a taser and zapped the fish at the injection site with a powerful taser. And so that's the effect of these snails. So most fish hunting cone snails have two cabals, a lightning strike cabal and a motor cabal, and we know the components of both of those cabals pretty well at this point. So why do you need two cabals? If you have a lightning strike cabal, which acts in a few seconds, why do you need a motor cabal? So here's a snail in real time. It's immobilized the fish. That's obviously the lightning strike cabal. You can see that it has very, very stiff fins. That, of course, allows the snail to completely engulf the fish. And the reason I'm showing you this video is something odd happened. The fish recovered. But of course it's too late, because the fish is already within the false rostrum of the snail. However, we have seen these snails harpoon a fish, and as they're reeling it in, especially if it's a big fish, the fish will recover, and when it recovers, the fish is able to tear itself and escape and swim away. But what we always see is when that happens, the snail does a little search of the neighborhood, expecting to find a paralyzed fish. So every snail that hunts fish that uses this strategy and has a lightning strike cabal also has a motor cabal. And so what that tells us is evolution is an extremely hard taskmaster. If you're going to be a successful fish hunting cone snail species, you have to have both, because you gain enough by having a motor cabal so that you maximize the probability that you will capture your prey when you go foraging. So I think you can see that most fish hunting cone snails are pretty sophisticated, but now I'd like to get into biodiversity. And we know how all the cone snails are related to each other pretty well, because a molecular genetic phylogenetic tree has been done. And what emerged from that is that there are multiple clades of fish hunting cone snails. So most cone snails are worm hunting, and so if there's a W, those are worm hunting cone snails. There are a few clades of mollusk hunting cone snails, but as you can see, there are separate clades of fish hunting cone snails. So what does this mean, that you have different branches of a tree? Phylogenetics, of course, you look at mitochondrial DNA and that's what you get. But what's the real biological meaning? And one of the consequences of having this tree is we've looked carefully at what is the strategy of the cone snails in these different clades for catching fish. And we were surprised when we looked at the two most closely related clades. So the one I've been talking about so far is F2, but in fact, Conus geographus belongs to the F1 clade called Gastridium, which is a very small clade. And when you present Conus geographus with a fish, it has an entirely different behavior. Instead of sticking its proboscis out, Conus geographus opens its mouth. And it has a very big mouth. And you can see that it has really a cavernous mouth, you might say. And another species in that clade, Conus tulipa, does the same thing, but there's a variation. This cilia on its mouth, it always opens its mouth, it always engulfs the fish, and then, only then, does it inject venom. So these snails do not stick their proboscis out. They do not use a hook and line strategy. They open their mouth really wide. And so, again, fish hunting cone snails learn that there's more than one way to catch a fish. You can use a hook and line or you can use a net. And so we call this the net strategy. So ecologically, it appears that what these snails do is they come out of the reef at night, they're inactive during the day, and they look for schools of small fish that are hiding in crevices of the reef. And they approach the whole school, and if they're lucky, they can bag the whole school, and they can then sting them individually. And so, instead of going after one fish at a time, these snails go after schools of fish. So evolution has taken a different direction here. Instead of focusing on capturing one target prey and maximizing the probability that you're going to capture that one targeted prey, here the evolution is, let's catch as many fish as possible when we go foraging. And so what you'll see is that this has its pharmacological consequences. If you're going to use this strategy, then you have to have a different way of capturing the fish. So what we've found is that they do not have a lightning strike cabal. Instead, they have what we call the nirvana cabal. These snails approach a fish and they apparently release some components of the venom into the water, and that makes the fish very disoriented. They deprive the fish of sensory modalities, particularly the hair cell system, and that allows them to engulf the fish, and then after they've engulfed the fish, they inject the fish with venom and they cause an irreversible paralysis. So they also have a motor cabal. So they do not have delta toxins, they do not have kappa toxins. Instead, what they have are a series of toxins that target sensory circuitry, and we believe what this does is it makes the fish disoriented, they're unable to feel movement in the water, it allows the snail to get as close to the fish as possible. Now, recently, we were surprised to find that a component of the nirvana cabal is an insulin, and they have a very high level of insulin that they release into the water. And this insulin is very similar to fish insulin, to native fish insulin, except that it has been stripped down and it's the smallest functional insulin that's ever been found. And so the strategy of the snails is when you use the net strategy, not only do you disorient the fish by wiping out the sensory circuitry, the hair cell system, but you make the fish hypoglycemic. And so by releasing this very potent insulin, they are doing two things. They're affecting the nervous system of the fish, but they're also affecting energy metabolism. And so what happens is that the fish get very low glucose, and as a result, not only are they disoriented, but they're hypoglycemic. That makes the whole school, so all of the fish are affected at the same time, and so that makes the whole school much easier to capture. And we've even seen in an aquarium, when there's a single fish that's far away, the snail sometimes makes its mouth like the barrel of a gun so that it can focus the venom components it's releasing. And after a while, this fish will swim in a funny way and will become far less active and much easier to engulf. And so here's a picture of Conus geographus in the wild. At the end of my talk, I'll have these shells out here. But what you'll find is that Conus geographus is an extremely light shell. And it turns out it's very, very agile compared to other cone snails. So here's another cone snail that uses the lightning strike cabal strategy. And it has a much heavier shell because all it has to do is get out of the sand once in a while and harpoon a fish. But this guy really has to approach schools of fish. And what we were astonished by is in an aquarium, we saw a Conus geographus one night get on top of another Conus geographus on the side of the aquarium and begin to lower itself with a thread, a mucus thread, very much like a spider lowering itself on a silk thread. And that's really quite an amazing sight if you consider this is a 5-inch snail that now is levitating itself downwards. So there are a number of adaptations that Conus geographus has made as part of its strategy for catching a whole school of fish. And so one of them, we think, is the light shell and the ability, when it sees, perceives a school of fish in a crevice, to lower itself so that now it can get close to the school and really begin to release components of the venom that make the school both hypoglycemic and sensory derived. And there's even some literature in the internet that supports that these are what the snails do. Here's a picture that somebody took in Australia, and what you can see, and this is in the wild, and the guy couldn't figure out what are the snails doing. But this suggests that maybe multiple individuals of Conus geographus come out and attack a school together by releasing, of course, components of the venom. And that would raise the concentration of the venom components that make the fish both sensory deprived and hypoglycemic. And so there's a lot we don't know about Conus geographus. But as you can see, we've rationalized some of the components that we found in the venom. So that's a progress report on where we are with the biology. The pharmacology of Conus geographus has been useful in a number of ways. It's the source of a peptide called omega-conotoxin G6A, which many neuroscientists use to inhibit synaptic transmission at the presynaptic terminus. But these two peptides, isolated by undergraduates, contralokin G, a sluggish peptide, as it was called, and the sleeper peptide of Craig Clark, have both reached human clinical trials, one for intractable pain, in the case of this contralokin G, which is a neurotensin homologue, and conotoxin G for intractable epilepsy, which this is a subtype-specific NMDA receptor antagonist. So these very crude assays have led to some possible therapeutic applications. The remarkable thing is that each venom has its own set of peptides. There's essentially no molecular overlap. And so the genes that encode the peptides are subject to accelerated evolution. And so you might ask, why are there so many different peptides in each venom? And why do you have different venom components in each species? And the answer seems to be that they use their venom not just for prey capture, but also to defend against predators and to deter competitors. And so they use their venom for all of their biotic interactions. And our rationale for why these venom components diverge is because every species has its own particular ecological niche. And what that implies is that every species has different prey, different predators, different competitors. And so when you evolve species in a biodiverse lineage and you want it to be as fit as possible for that particular ecological niche, these are the genes that have to change. And so these are the genes that change as new species evolve. Housekeeping genes remain constant, but these genes that encode venom components have accelerated evolution. So what I'd like to end up with, since we are honoring Palmer today, is a few results on nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. And it turns out that the same Michael McIntosh, as an undergraduate, essentially characterized Prion, is also the leader in the field in terms of characterizing conus venom components that differentiate between heteromeric nicotinic receptors. And so in Ryan's talk, he emphasized that we really don't know too much about heteromeric ion channels, but I think having pharmacological agents that differentiate between different nicotinic receptors is a step in that direction. And of course, we heard earlier today about how the crystal structure of the interactions with one of these conotoxins, IM1, was done in Palmer's lab by Scott and in collaboration with Pascal and Eves. So we do know that they are able to get their specificity by having determinants in two adjacent subunits. And what Michael has been able to do is to take various peptides from different snails and sometimes change them a little bit, so that now he has a toolkit that is very specific even for nicotinic receptors that are related. And so the all alpha type of nicotinic receptors where you have alpha 7, alpha 9, alpha 10 subunits, he has peptides that can differentiate between alpha 7 and alpha 9, alpha 10. And the difference is many orders of magnitude. And so it turns out that if you have these peptides, sometimes you get unexpected results. And it's the peptide that was specific for alpha 9, alpha 10, called RG1A, turns out to be an anti-nociceptive. And so when you have an animal model of pain, chronic constriction injury, then you get, you measure pain by looking at the withdrawal threshold. And so here's the baseline. And now when you have the chronic constriction injury, you can see that the threshold is much lower. And now if you inject this peptide, what happens is that you alleviate the pain and therefore you at this dose return to controlled conditions. Now, what's amazing is that this peptide doesn't last very long after you inject it into an animal. Perhaps it lasts only half an hour or an hour. But it appears that this peptide is actually disease altering. If you inject it after a nerve injury, what happens is that the animals never develop a pain syndrome. And it seems that the reason is that the target of this peptide, the alpha 9, alpha 10 receptor, is expressed in immune cells, and that somehow there's communication between an injured nerve and the immune cells. And so what happens is that you get the accumulation of macrophages and lymphocytes at the site of injury. But if you inject the peptide when you have the nerve injury, then you don't get the accumulation of those cells. And so this is an anti-inflammatory. You do not see inflammation induced by the chronic constriction injury. What's interesting is that you have to have a very specific ligand for the alpha 9, alpha 10 receptor. And most small molecule ligands do not distinguish between alpha 7 and alpha 9, alpha 10. And what Michael has shown is that if you take the peptide that's specific for alpha 7, you don't decrease the inflammation, you increase the inflammation. And so you have an increase in the number of macrophages and lymphocytes that accumulate. And so it appears that the signals that are mediated by these two types of nicotinic receptors in an inflammation are really very, very different. Now, the hour is getting late. I have another story on nicotinic receptors, but I think I'll skip that. It's nicotinic receptors and Parkinson's, because I want to get to the end of my talk, which is the future. So I've told you the story of one cone snail, and there are 700 or 800 cone snails, but these are not the only venomous animals in the ocean that are snails. There are two other groups, auger snails that live in sand and are very long and look like this, and turids, which have diverse morphology. And it turns out that from the biodiversity point of view, cone snails are a very minor component of the total biodiversity of venomous snails. The real action is in the turids, where there are 12,000 species of turids. So why haven't people looked at turids and analyzed turids in the past? There are two reasons. One is, in the old days, if you're going to do anything, you needed biochemical amounts, and the problem is that cone snails are large, you can collect lots of them in shallow water. Turids are very small, most of them are deep water, but there has been a breakthrough. And so what I'd like to tell you about is the breakthrough that I think affects the future of looking at venomous snails. And the breakthrough is not high tech, so for the students in the audience, or postdocs, or young faculty members, not all breakthroughs have to be high tech. This is the lowest tech breakthrough you can think of. This is a fisherman in the Philippines, and what he's doing is he's looking for the end of a rope that he's tied to the edge of a reef next to a wall. The other end of the rope goes 50 meters down, and he had tied this rope 5 months earlier to that rock, and what he's now going to do is he's going to retrieve what he's tied in the other end of the rope, which are old fishing nets that have been tied in a bundle, a very tight bundle, which in the local dialect is called lumen lumen. And as you can see, this is very high-tech operation here, and so now he's beginning to take the nets from the bottom, and what you're going to see is that those nets are going to be brought to the boat. So this is a fairly laborious process. Why are the fishermen doing this? Well, there's an economic incentive. So in Japan, people love to give their kids microscopes, and they want their kids to be looking at natural history objects. And so they're always coming to the Philippines and they're saying, can you get us some microscopic shells? And if you've tried to look for microscopic shells, they're really a pain to find. And so some clever fisherman found that all you had to do was tie together these old fishing nets, drop them in deep water, and then pull your net up after a couple of months or more. And then all you had to do was shake this net, and you would end up with lots and lots of very, very small snails. And now the guy from Japan comes, and the fishermen have this whole bunch of small snails to sell, and the middleman from Japan comes, and then he puts the snails in little glassine envelopes like this, which they then sell for outrageous prices in Tokyo hobby shops. So today, in honor of Palmer, and as a memento of this outstanding occasion, I'm going to hand out little envelopes like this, which is the result of this lumen lumen fishery. And you'll be amazed, because when you look at this, these are mature shells. And what we did with the net that I showed you is we analyzed what was in that net. So here's the commercial product that the guy from the hobby shops in Japan pick up. But if you look at what was in that net, there were over 1,000 organisms in the net, 300 different species. The biggest group were the snails, with 155 different species in that net, 600 individuals. And when we looked at what those species were, what we were gratified to find was that there were 30 different turret species in that one net. So every net has many, many turret species, and this is what they look like. And we've analyzed this one and a couple of others. And when you look at the transcriptome in the venom duct, there are over 100 different toxins. And so even if you have something that's a few millimeters long, that does not mean that it doesn't have the biological complexity that's equivalent to Conus geographus. And so now, instead of having 700 cone snails to work through, there are 12,000 species, and each one presumably has a story, a biological background that's as complex and as rich as Conus geographus, and the biotic interactions of each of these species is something, of course, that we don't understand at all. But we have made a start with the pharmacology. We've begun to isolate one of these turret peptides, and what you see here is the first one that we've characterized. And what's interesting is that it seems to be a novel potassium channel blocker that only blocks a heteromeric combination that contains the Kv1.6 subunit. And so I think we're going to need all the biodiversity we can get if we're going to begin to address the complexity of heteromeric potassium channels, because there are 70 genes and they're tetramers, and most of them are probably heteromeric, and we know very little about them at this time. So with that thought, I'd like to close and just acknowledge all of my collaborators and people in the lab over the years. And I think we are handing out the snails in the back table over there. And let's have a special delivery for this table. I think we want to make sure that everybody on this table gets a souvenir cone snail. So they're both cone snails. And essentially, if you look at this under a microscope, you'll see very, very many species. But the gratifying thing is 1/5 of the species that you'll find in these envelopes are turrets, and each of those species has 100 or 200 natural products that are probably targeted to ion channels and receptors. So I'd like to, again, add my bit wishing Palmer well, and we would love for the kids to look at those shells and remember this night. Thank you very much for your attention. This species in particular, if you have it in an aquarium and you starve them for a little while, what will happen is that when you add fish to the aquarium, if you add too many fish, they'll all come out, and then you'll saturate their chemoreceptors if you add too many fish. And so under those conditions, they all have their proboscis out, and they can't tell where the fish are anymore because you've saturated their chemoreceptors, and they'll sting anything that moves. And so what happens is they'll sting a conspecific, and typically that snail that gets stung, you'll find dead in the tank the following day.
Poison sac.
Yes.
That stores it must have an incredible concentration, and if some of those leak out,
So I think it's very, very well lined with a thick collagen lining. So I think it's very compartmentalized. So as long as it's in their gut and as long as it's in the venom apparatus, it doesn't diffuse out. So we actually believe that in...
You have a central nervous system penetrating machine.
Right.
You're assaying, but the snail does not have a micro-injection state in the nervous system.
That is correct. And our prejudice is that, in fact, the real targets, the physiologically relevant targets in the envenomated animals are all peripheral. It's just that the central nervous system is a great assay system because every receptor and ion channel is expressed there. Yes,
so Bill. In the turrets, what are the venoms used for? Are they hunting the small prey or what?
Presumably. The big unanswered question about turrets is they're one of the few lineages of snails that become more and more biodiverse as you go deeper and deeper. And so when you go into really deep bottoms, 250 meters or so, you don't find any more cone snails, but you find lots and lots of species of turrets. And so, you know, people used to think the deep bottom of the sea was sort of like a desert and not very interesting. But obviously that can't be true. Because the speciation of things like turrets is really rather remarkable. So there must be stuff down there that they're partitioning because you find lots of species. But what they're eating, we don't know. The very few where it is known, they seem to be eating very small polychaete worms. But those are relatively shallow water ones. There are turrets, so cone snails are strictly tropical, but you even find turrets in Antarctica, and they're really very big ones as well. Yes?
Why the fabulous colors and patterns? Do they have a visual?
That's a really good question. So, you know, the standard explanation is the coral reef environment is patchy, and by having these complex patterns, they're actually looking more cryptic. That clearly can't be true for every species because especially species that live in mud, they get a periostracum, a thick coating. You can't see the pattern at all. And yet when you remove the organic layer, you see this beautiful color. And so I think what happens is that there's selection for certain patterns. And then if a species then evolves that lives in mud, it's sort of freewheeling, there's no selection. And then if it is in a ecological situation, then the pattern will be selected for again. But we really don't understand it. In fact, it's not even known how they make the dyes and how they make, you know, the complex patterns on the shells. Oh. I'm sorry, I didn't understand the comment very well.
I say, have you ever approached a video game company?
Oh, a video game company.
Like Angry Snail?
I'd love to do that if there's a video company that's... Thank you very much for the suggestion. So, at the back, they're both packets that have a lumen-lumen. And again, one out of every five species is a turret. But there are also two cone snails there. So I hope everybody has a souvenir of this great occasion with taking one of these and one of the cone snails. Thank you very much.